So it's now 6 o'clock. Hello and good evening from my end to everybody who is watching this Insta Live. I will be talking with Nurcan Baysal tonight about press freedom and the situation in Turkey, but also with regards to the COVID pandemic. We are just waiting for Nurcan to join us. She told me that it's her first Insta Live, so let's see whether she will manage to do it. And once Nurcan is with us, we will start our discussion for maybe half an hour, 40-45 minutes. I would just like to give her one or two more minutes and then we see. But it's good to have you with us, and I'm very happy to see you. And for all of you who are in this Insta Live for the first time, there's also another Insta Live that happened with Maria Ressa from the Philippines on similar issues, which you can watch in my Instagram TV. Still waiting for Nurcan. Let's see. So Nurcan is already with us, and now she requested to join us. We just have to wait a few seconds whether the techniques work out, but now it's just in the hands of
Anna.
It's so good to see you. It worked.
Yeah, perfect. Also for me. How are you?
I'm fine. Good evening. It's so great to see you and to see that you're fine. And thank you so much for joining me tonight.
It's my pleasure.
So I heard also it's your first Insta Live. So
yes, I'm so excited.
That's good, but it worked perfectly. So it's great that you're with us, and it's just 6:02, so we are perfectly on time. I think it's 7:02 in Turkey, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's good. Before we start, Nurcan, I would just like to explain to everyone how it works, and then quickly introduce myself, also introduce you, of course, as you are the guest and the most important person today, and then we can start to talk. So this is an Instagram Live. And it's kind of the second event of my little series on female voices from around the world talking about human rights, women's rights, but also how the corona pandemic is affecting them. There will be more to come, and I'm very happy to have Nurcan Baysal with me today. For those who don't know me, because they are your followers, I'm Hannah Neumann. I'm a member of the European Parliament, of the Green Party, but that doesn't matter so much. And I'm working on human rights and gender equality myself, which is why I'm so happy that we're having this event. Those of you who are watching and who want to, well, you can all send hearts and like wave at us, but you can also ask questions by either putting them in the comment section or where you see the question mark. So that's the Q&A, and I will try to follow basically your questions and see which ones we will manage to answer today. So, but it's not about me, it's mostly about Nurcan tonight, and I'm very happy that she is with us. Nurcan is born and raised in Diyarbakir, which is in Turkey, and I think you refer to yourself as a Kurdish journalist. So being Kurdish apparently is of some importance for you, and for those who follow the situation in Turkey for a while know that it makes quite a big difference whether you assign yourself the title Kurdish or not, but we'll be talking about that. Mm-hmm. You are a journalist, you're a writer, you're a member of PEN Turkey, and you are writing about issues that, and I found that very interesting, issues that for us in the European Union are very important when we speak about Turkey, so like human rights, the situation of women, war and peace, also the Syrian refugees, but that in the Turkish debate are rather absent.
Yeah.
And apparently that makes you a target. Because from what I understand, well, already being Kurdish is a bit of a problem in Turkey. Yeah. Being a woman that speaks up is a bit of a problem.
Yeah.
But and then speaking up about human rights and refugees makes you even more a target. So actually in March, I think it was March 30 or 31, so very much at the beginning of the COVID pandemic, you were one of those reporting about the COVID situation in the country. Yeah. Also just saying, well, apparently there's a pandemic, but no one seems to care. And that brought you into prison. So maybe we just start there. That's fine with you, Nurcan.
Yeah, sure.
Explain your experience. And I'm very happy to have you with me today.
Also for me. I'm not only the only one that, to be honest, to be in the detention at that time. Lots of other journalists also detained just because of their articles, writings, or because of the news. At the beginning of the COVID pandemic, Hannah, COVID is devastating lives in all around the world. And so it also has social and economic impacts. But in Turkey, because of the government policies, you know, they use the COVID pandemic as an excuse to stifle freedom of speech. And so they begin to make pressure at the, till from the beginning, they made pressure on journalists and on different doctors and different segments of the society. Mm-hmm. And just before telling about my situation, I want to give you a number, because on 21st of May, the interior minister, they shared some numbers with the public. It is so funny, because what the word they use, I want to tell this to you, because they said that according to interior ministry, 1,105 social media users had made terror propaganda by sharing provocative coronavirus posts.
So what would this be, this kind of provocative stuff they share?
Yeah, and together with terror, it is terror. They put it inside terror propaganda, and okay. More, 510 of these people are detained. So it's a really huge number, and these people are from different segments of the society. Just in the second week of the lockdown, it was the, because the lockdown began at 14th of March in Turkey. And just mm-hmm. in the second week, Malik Yılmaz, a lorry driver, okay, he shared just 3 minutes video on TikTok. Okay, and he just had 30 followers. And he said about his, he talked about his thoughts about stay home message. And he said that, I'm a lorry driver, I'm not rich. If I stay at home, I will not have anything to eat. The pandemic will not kill me, but your system will kill me. And immediately, he found himself in detention center. And 3 times, he was detained just because of these words. And he has a travel ban, etc. And sure, he lost his job. And the second segment of the society is journalists, you know, that's really targeted during the pandemic. And I think I am one of them, the first ones, just again, the second week of the pandemic. I took a call from the police station, and I don't know why every time I was not expecting, you know, still. And then I said, they said, you need to come to the police station. I said, there's pandemic, there's no one outside, you know. Please, after the pandemic, I know they said it's urgent. And I went, I was the only one at outside, okay? And I went to the police station. And then there I learned that, and first they said that you are under detention. Mm-hmm. I was shocked.
And but what exactly did you do? Why did they put you in the police station?
Then they told me that I'm under detention because of 2 of my articles about COVID measures in my city and in Kurdish region. And 8 of my social media posts, Twitter posts, about, again, COVID measures and COVID risk in the prisons.
But what is it that you have been writing in these posts that made them so angry?
In that, I didn't criticize the state a lot in that articles, to be honest. I usually criticize more. But in that articles, I also criticize more also to our people, why you are, you know, out, and some measures are like, we don't have the tests at that time. Mm-hmm. And also I said, told about the, I talked with some of the family, prisoners' families, mm-hmm. and they told me about the situation in prisons. So I wrote about them.
And I think for our listeners, it's important to know, because not everybody's familiar with the situation in Turkey, that in Turkey, actually many prisoners could leave the prison because of COVID, but not the political prisoners.
Not the political.
So people who were violent and who were beating up, or who were even, I think, charged with rape, they were allowed to leave, but not people who were in prison just because they spoke up or they were journalists.
Yeah, political prisoners, journalists, Kurdish people mainly, Kurdish activists, you know, all these people, political prisoners, they didn't get released, but all the others released. And some of them are cancer. They have really very, you know, mm-hmm. hard illnesses. And I wrote about them. I interviewed with the family. And then they told me that you are lucky because there's coronavirus, so you will not be in detention center tonight. Just mm-hmm. go home, but tomorrow you will come and you need to go to prosecutor. Then I went to the prosecutor and judge, you know, it took 2 days. And then, you know, we had a long discussion with the prosecutor, and he told me that you are not an ordinary person. You have an effect on Kurdish society, so you should mm-hmm. be very careful what you are writing. Okay.
But basically, what you wrote was people should stay at home.
Mainly this. Mm-hmm. It's so funny. And but very, very strange thing. Also, I need to special also thank to you and some other European parliamentarians, because at that time you all shared, you know, messages about me. And all these messages were printed on the table of the prosecutor.
Oh, yeah. So apparently it has some impact, because I always wonder with all these messages and tweets we write, whether it really does something, but at least it made it to the table. But was that helpful, or was that even making things worse?
It is helpful. It was just printed all, because when I entered the police station, immediately UN Special Rapporteur Michelle Force and all of you, you know, everyone sent messages in from all over the world, Amnesty and Frontline Defenders, Civil Rights, all these institutions. And then probably the second day, you know, it affected and they released me, you know. And sure, it affects, you know, solidarity is not just a word, but all your messages from Brussels, from Paris, from London has an effect in our lives. Okay. So I think it is so it's really important. I saw them all printed, you know. And then
it's funny actually that they print them. That also tells us something, right?
Yeah, they printed and I saw it. Yeah, and then I returned home. But then 2 weeks later, you probably don't know it, I was again called for the police from the police station.
So that was in April, I guess, around Easter or something.
Yeah, in April, this time from a very bizarre investigation. They opened an investigation against me because of my pinned tweet on my Twitter profile since 2018. Okay, and on the, you know, in that pinned tweet, I only said, you know, don't be hopeless. Okay, look at, if you feel so, just show solidarity with the people who lost their homes in Sur, in Cizre, and other places. Mm-hmm. And when you feel so hopeless, just look at this sky. The stars are still there. Just this, and one of my photos looking to the sky.
Very revolutionary.
And because of this, for saying looking up to the sky, okay, they again accuse me, okay, to spread hatred and enmity among the society. I said, how? Just looking up to the sky. But this time I was so angry. So I took the constitution with me and I went to the police station with the constitution. I begin to read the constitution. They want me to stop. I said, no, because now what you are doing is that you are just, you know, you are what you are doing is now you are, you know, not obeying to the constitution. So I want to read you what you should do because you don't know, I said. And like 1 hour, I read the constitution in the
For 1 hour. So how long is your constitution? I think our gazettes would have been gone after 20 minutes.
Yeah, not all of them, but I read many of them. And I read my rights as a citizen. And I read what they should do, you know, as a police officer, etc., etc. And they again took my interrogation and then I was released again. But during the coronavirus, I took 2 times.
But since then, they basically did not summon you anymore to the police station or to the court. So now it's just pending and we don't know? Is the status?
We don't know. This year, nearly, they opened literally 10 investigations against me. And I had, in the last 2 years, I took a 10-month prison sentence. And I have 2 home raids, 3 detention, and nearly maybe 15 investigations. Yeah,
I remember with these raids also happening in 2015. So that was not the first time that you had this unpleasant experience.
Yeah, in the first raid, home raid was in 2018, but it was so brutal way. They break down my home, break down my door, and they entered my home like that. And at the beginning, I thought it was an earthquake. Then I realized that the voice sound is coming from my door, and you know, I can't tell how it was because I was trying to hide the kids because I thought that a war occurred, and they came to kill us. They are bombing my home, and I was just calling the kids, just trying to hide them. It was.
How many kids do you have?
I have to.
So that doesn't make things easier, I can imagine.
It is hard, really. And then this year, I went to London as a guest of English Pen. I'm also a member of English Pen. And then again, when I was in London, there's another home rate. You know, in the first home rate in 2018, they took me in prison because of using the word war. And in the second, in the first week.
You referred with the war to the invasion of Turkey in Syria. Yeah. And you referred to this as a war.
I never say invasion.
Well, I would say invasion because I live in European Union. And
yes.
So you just used war, and already that was bad enough to put you into this raid and prison and stuff. Okay.
Yeah, Hannah, it is like really I'm dancing around the words. Okay, when I write something. Because in my first detention, I put in prison because of using the word war. Okay. In my second detention, in the second home raid, they did it because of using the word peace. Okay. And it is so funny because every time, you know, I am thinking that should I use the word invasion, occupation, you know, should I use the word war? Should I use the word peace? Okay, because all these words don't only have an effect on my life, but also on the lives of my children, okay? Every time, because of the words, they are taking me. And we have also, it's the war with the words also. For example, now, the name of my city, the Kurdish name is Ahmet. And during the peace process, we were using both names, Ahmet and Diyarbakır is a Turkish name. Okay, and both names are in everywhere, in billboards, in official places, everywhere, okay? But then after the peace process, you know, stopped, and now it is forbidden to use the word Ahmet, okay? And then we were always, the name of our region is Kurdistan, okay?
But that is a problem too.
I cannot use it now. Okay, but you know, before 2015, in all my articles, I was using Kurdistan. And so what we are doing, this makes us to do strange, very strange things we are doing sometimes. It is so hard for a foreigner to understand, you know, because then, okay, I say, let's use Kurdish region. But sometimes this is not also good. Then we say the region, okay. And then if you write Southeast region, then the Kurdish people outside the country, they say how kind of Kurdish you are. Okay, all these things.
That they send you a letter saying, please use this word, but you have to find out by being put into prison and released.
Yeah, and because one of my investigations 2 years ago, because of using the word Kurd, I still use, I continue to use, they are opening investigation because the name of my region is this, okay? And but every time they open investigation, and it is so funny because we do funny things. For example, another word, okay, enters in our life in 2016 is Kayyum. Kayyum means state trustee, okay? Because in 2016, they put our mayors in prison and they appointed state trustees instead of our elected Kurdish mayors, okay? But state trustee, we say Kayyum, is a bad word for us. Kayyum want us to tell, to say the mayor. No, he's not mayor, he's Kayyum, okay?
But of course, that word gets you into trouble as well, I can imagine.
Yeah, because he holds power in our city. So it is like, you know, I am talking to you from a city, his name is Bent. I'm talking, my city is in a region, his name is also Bent. Something is happening, I can't.
And the person ruling that city's name is also Bent. So basically, you cannot even speak about your homeland anymore because they are taking the words away from
you.
So
every time, you know, I'm trying to find some way, some other things. But no one becomes happy. Someone says, why you are not using this? Someone might say, why you use the Arabic? Why you didn't? Oh, it's like, you know, fight for everything, you know? So, and 2 years ago, seven university students in Dijde University, they put in prison because of whistling in Kurdish. Whistling, like, you know, whistling. I don't know how it is to be still. What is the difference between whistling in Kurdish and Turkish? I really don't know it.
But, so the problem is not that they have been whistling, but that they have been whistling in Kurdish.
Yeah, whistling in Kurdish. It is the, you know, in the, it writes whistling in Kurdish. Probably, you know, I watched the video a few times. I wrote an article about it. And because they are whistling the song of a Kurdish song, you know.
A Kurdish song, okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And they are whistling it because they can't sing it. So they whistle it, okay. And it from one side it is funny, but from one side it is said they are in prison. So it is like that, you know.
It's a bit like that we're using this way to make fun about it so we can bear it, because it's so confusing and distracting and horrible that either you just fall, I think, for all this horribleness and then you're sad all day, or you start making fun, which is also sad in itself, huh?
You know, it is together because it is something like that. You know, sometimes people, it is so hard for people to understand. I will give you one example, because during the bombardment, during the curfew, military curfews, it was in Diyarbakir, it began at the December of 2015. And still, you know, it continues, but there is no, you know, military operation anymore. And then some of the very Democrat journalists, you know, intellectuals, they came to visit the region. Okay, it was during the bombardment. And then they returned. They are my friends, very good people. And on the TVs, I watched them. They were like, oh, we didn't understand how, you know, from one side there is bombardment on the one part of the city, but from other side people are drinking coffee, you know. Then I wrote an article.
But that is what war is about in so many countries. It's just that out there you'd fail to understand it if you never experienced it.
Yeah, they don't understand it. Then I wrote an article, and its name was "Yes, We Still Drink Coffee." And also a book published with that name now. It's in English, you can read, okay? And in that article, I tried to tell them how it is to live in war for 2 years, you know. It becomes part of you, you know.
Well, you can't stop drinking coffee for 4 years just because people are throwing bombs.
Yeah, I said, you know, it is part of my life. I have some different habits than you. For example, every Friday is my day to send books to prison. You know, we need to take care of the people who lost their loved ones. You know, we have some different things in our lives. But from other side, yes, I also eat 3 times in a day, like you. I also drink coffee. And if still I'm staying in Diyarbakir, if still I continue to write, it is a struggle. Struggle is not only just to go walk and say all these slogans. But if I still live here, it is a struggle. You know, all these things are struggle, I said, just to appreciate us. You know, we are living here under the bombardments, but it is part of our life. My kids know that if there's bombardment, you know, in which part inside the school room they will stay. So we are living
it's just a normal part of your life, and it doesn't make it any better. It actually just makes it much more sad that you are getting so used to sending books to prisons on Fridays.
Yeah.
I mean, but I have very few friends who do this, but I know that for many of you, it's just a normal way of continuing to have contact.
Because they are waiting yet. Yeah. But
Nurcan, can I ask you?
Yeah, please.
Because it was really touching me when you spoke about the fact that being put into prison or having these raids is not just a raid on you or you being away, but it means a lot for your family and your children. And I know, my situation is very different. I live in the European Union, we have freedom of speech, but when I decided to step up in a political office in a constituency where there are many right-wing persons, I also knew it's not just a decision I make for me, but it's a decision I make for the whole family to have this visibility on combating nationalism and racism.
Yeah.
And that, well, at some point it will also target my kids, either indirectly, by the way you describe it, but also when you walk down the streets and, well, basically they attack you in the streets and you have the kids with you. So I know how hard this was for me to make this decision for my whole family. Mm-hmm. So I just wonder, how did you at some point make this decision deliberately, or did it just happen? And how are you dealing with this part of the work?
I can't deal. Still, I can't, you know, it is something like that, because from all parts of society, always this message is coming to you. You are not a good mother, you know, because people think that, you know, to be a human rights defender and to be a woman human rights defender is so different, really. Even your own mother is saying, you should stay at home. You have 2 kids. You are not thinking about your 2 kids. And always you feel guilt. Okay, always it is my heart with guilt, and guilt and responsibility always goes together. And it is like, for example, in my last detention during the coronavirus, I came at home and I see the fear in the eyes of my children. And I begin to talk, maybe I need to stop, I say to myself. If I go to in prison during the coronavirus, who will take care of them? I don't have also big family that can take care of them. You know, I am alone trying to take care of my children. And you are thinking all these things, you know. And also you never have time for personal grief. And you don't never stop. And I don't stop and think, because we also lost lots of people during this war, you know. You are always losing something. You are always losing something. And it goes like that. It's not, it is so hard. You are, as a woman, to be honest, I'm so alone. I am so alone. People usually, even our own society, they don't support. You know, there is always this prejudice for women, okay? They don't, people
and you're
don't
stepping
like
out of the space for women, so.
Yeah, and you know, people don't like to see brave women. It is so hard. It's so hard, really, to be brave. Even in your own society, it is so hard. You are not, I'm not just dealing to be Kurdish or writing these human rights violations, also dealing with women, because when they can't deal with your articles, you know, with all these things, then they are looking to you and trying to scrutinize you, your looking, you know, or you know, what you wear, you know, what you eat, how is your life, you know, all this thing about women. Even they, you know, they are on social media, they wrote, why you are smiling? Why you are, there is nothing to smile. I am the one who live in Diyarbakir, okay? And they are asking me to stop smiling. I'm like you. I'm like you, you know? It, like, I'm a human being, you know? If my kids do a joke, I smile, you know, like a human being. I eat like you, you know? And but they expect, for example, just 2 days ago, there were something about the LGBT communities, and I shared my photo on Instagram and on Twitter with, you know, LGBT colors. And you should see all the comments came, and it was so bad, some of them. From some Kurdish people says, you should know your place, you know?
Oh, yes, this discussion.
It comes on top.
It's so incredible. Like, I mean, as I said, being Kurdish already is a lot, comes with a lot of discrimination. And then even within that, they give you an extra hard life because you should know your place. I mean, what a sentence. Oh,
yeah, because it's because
what a useless sentence.
Yeah,
and maybe that is the strongest signal you send to your kids, just telling them we don't accept that.
Yeah. The thing is that I believe two things are enough. But the first thing is that I believe to struggle on the front, because badness, all these races, everyone is on the front. Okay, I don't believe struggle silence. No, you know, we should put good things in front of our next generation. And second thing, what I believe is that we need to want human rights for everyone, not just, we can't protect human rights just in our own neighborhood, okay? Yes, I am Kurdish, and I am fighting, struggling for the rights of me, my people. But
and you are a woman, and you still speak up.
Yeah, but I'm also struggling for the rights of Syrians, Romans, Armenians, Yazidis, for all of them, you know. If I only want these rights for me, this is not human rights. You understand, human rights is something, you know, it's really so important for me. If we don't be, you know, if you don't realize it on the ground, then what is it? It will be just a word, you know. So it is so important to demand human rights for all people, not just for own neighborhoods. But this is like that, you know, 2 days ago, lots of I saw hate, you know, things they wrote to me. But, you know, I used to, after a while, it goes, you know.
But what is it that gives you this strength, Nurcan? Because, I mean, we all know it's not just the social media. So with this, at least for me, with the social media one, I can deal. But when it happens in real life, and with me, it's just people saying swear words or putting stuff on my home, but it's not being put in prison or the experience you have. What gives you the strength to continue this?
Maybe I from one side I'm so alone, but from other side I feel it's not a struggle of today, it's a struggle of hundreds of years. I look it like that, you know. It's like a river. It is for me, it's like a freedom river. Okay, 100 years ago some other people struggled, and those rivers flowed and came to us, you know. It maybe today is not flowing widely, you know, but it should flow. And people like you, like me, if we don't put some water on it, how it will flow and to continue to the next generation. You know, I feel myself as a part of this, you know, as a part of this river. It's something like that. I am sure 200 years ago in Europe somewhere, a woman faced the same things, you know. And I'm sure that there are some other women struggling now, you know, everywhere all together. And you know, the bad thing is that, you know, here in Turkey, there's a bad proverb, and they said that woman is the enemy of woman. No, I don't believe this. Woman is the home of woman. This is what I believe. I believe sisterhood. And so I believe all these things. I don't know, you know, it is just me, you know, it's not, I don't need big things. I, you know, just sometimes people ask why, you know, you begin to deal with all these things. It is just being human, about being human. An accident happened in front of me, and I know that I can do something for those people inside the car. And this is what I am doing. And the war occurred again and again. And I know that I can write. I know that I can go these villages. I know that I'm lucky. I am really lucky, because lots of people are not still, like, they are in prison. I know that I can take their voice to the outside of the country. Mm-hmm. And so how can I close? There's an accident on front of me, and it continues. It's something like that.
And you have, like, allies or sisters or, like, a certain ritual that gives you strength, especially when things are really bad? Or is it just looking at your kids and building a better world for them?
Yeah, the kids are important, but the solidarity. I am really, if I keep going, it is because of this solidarity. Because a lot of times I thought, okay, I should stop. For example, in my detention during the coronavirus, it affected me a lot because it was coronavirus, you know.
And how long was the detention?
It was just, you know, I didn't stay even detention center because of corona. I'm lucky because they sent me home. But the thing is that I asked myself if I should stop. Mm-hmm. But the thing is that then I wrote it. On Twitter, I said, I'm asking myself, maybe I should stop. And then from all over the world, I took messages, you know. And then sometimes, you know, just one thank you, you know.
You see it even here, right? In the chat, like, everybody's saying thank you so much, even in German and Turkish and English and every language.
Yeah, this is, you know, I always telling this also to my children. If you can't do anything, just appreciate. Just appreciate these people who are working for the society. Just one thanks, just sometimes one thank you makes me really to keep going. So solidarity is very, very important. And I'm lucky. I'm so lucky because I was able to establish all these relations with international institutions, with the other people, with Armenians, with Yazidis, with all over the world. But lots of people are in my region, they are not so lucky as me. Mm-hmm. You know, they are in prison. No one hears their voices. So, you know, I'm thinking them and trying to take their voice to out, you know, this is what I'm trying my best.
It sounds like still a very powerful force that is driving you, and maybe that's what is needed to continue work under such circumstances.
Yeah, there is no other way, I think. There is no other way for me, because when I was in the UK, because of the home rate, a lot of embassies, even from some governments, they called me. Some MPs from some countries, they said that to come to this country, some European countries, they said that we want to give you asylum. I said, no, it is not a choice for me to leave my country. I will return. They want me not to return. You know, they want me to wait 1 year. Well, no, I said, this is what they want. This is what they want. It is never an option for me.
It's like this, if we give in, then they won already. Yeah, it's that thing that I was thinking when I had that question. So will I step up? And I thought, yeah. Well, and that reason would be a good reason not to go. And then I said, but well, if I give in now, then they won.
Yeah, this is what they
want. I think it's that what is driving us as well. Huh?
And what I demand? I demand my most fundamental human right to live free in the land which I, you know, born. You know, this is my fundamental human right. You know, and I don't want to leave this. I don't want to leave my land, my people. You know. And so I returned. I was expecting that they will take me at the airport, but I'm lucky that.
Well, I think some of this, like, visibility and fame outside of Turkey gives some protection, at least. I'm always telling that to myself so that my work makes some sense.
Yeah, all this, also international institutions, I really understand the importance of them, Hannah. You know, because probably I will be in prison if I don't have this international solidarity. Mm-hmm. In 2018, I was thinking that I will stay in prison. But at that year, the frontline defenders, they gave me the Global Laureate Award of Human Rights Defenders, and that protected me. The award day,
oh,
I had the court trial. I had the court trial that day, and they released, you know, just, you know. And all these things, you know, all this, you know, solidarity of from these institutions, from the, you know, from the parliamentarians, like, you know, it is really, it affects our lives. I clearly and openly say this, all these messages affects our lives. So we should always think about how we can increase this solidarity, because I am lucky, but most of the people, they are not lucky as me. So we should think about this. Mm-hmm. And for example, I recommend some embassies, and also, I don't know if European Parliament can do things like that, but to devote maybe a year to human rights defenders. Just, you know, in the last 2 or 3 years, I don't remember now, 52 human rights defenders were killed around the world. And so it is important, you know, to point to this issue and to thank to these people, all these things, because affects the lives, I think, you know. Just, you know, in my case, I see that it affects my life. You know, as I say, all this, your messages are printed in front of the prosecutor.
I really wasn't aware of that.
Yeah.
It's good to hear. So you say solidarity and just putting a spotlight on this situation, yeah, is something, yeah, that helps. What else can we do, Nurcan?
What else can you do? I think meeting with human rights defenders in our region is also important. In Turkey, everything is, you know, when everything is based in Ankara or in Istanbul, mainly in Istanbul. Okay. Mm-hmm. And Istanbul is sometimes more far away than me to from Brazil when I compare with the Brazil. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I can reach Brussels more easier, believe me. You know, and I'm sure lots of local journalists and human rights defenders, they are like me. Even in their capitals, they can't make their voices heard in their mm-hmm. own capitals. But when it is about the Kurdish people, you know, because it's a colonized society at the end. And we have these hierarchies everywhere, even inside the human rights movement. So we, because of this, to visit the region, you know, mm-hmm. it is important to meet with the human rights defenders in the region. It is important.
It's really a big problem that at the moment we cannot travel. I so much hate this.
Yeah.
It really hurts my heart that now this is the best we can do, these kind of Instagram things, and we are lacking this exchange. And for me, it also means it's much harder to bring the voices of people who are not sitting in the capitals, who may not even be able to use digital technology like the two of us, to bring their voices to parliament, because usually I go.
Yeah,
I cannot go, and it really hurts me.
Maybe after the pandemic, because I tell this also to the ambassadors. You know, when you are in Ankara, how you will understand the Kurdish issue? For example, in my city, we still have curfew. There is no one lives inside the curfew area anymore, so it's a stupid curfew. We don't know why. Okay, but it is the longest curfew in the world. Okay, it is in the historical city center, a city center that under the protection of UNESCO. Okay. Mm-hmm. And when I say this to the ambassadors, they say, oh, really? Yeah, oh, really? Because you don't come and you don't visit us. You don't visit these cities. It is so important because, you know, as I said, here it's a colonized society. You should be aware of this. And so you should visit the region, I think, often. What can you do more?
I hope I will be able to do that soon.
Hmm? Yeah,
I hope I will be able to travel soon. I think we all miss that so much.
I will wait after the pandemic. And also to make these people visible. I think this is important. I'm visible, but many other people, they are not visible. Okay, there are, you know, for example, in Cizre, people don't know what's happening in Cizre. Or in Yüksekova, at the border with, you know, Iran and Iraq. And we have Şırnak. It is really hard to take information from Şırnak, from Bitlis, from all these areas. And so we don't have usually international organizations, they expect us to establish solidarity mechanisms, you know, regional mm-hmm. solidarity mechanisms. We can't because, you know, we don't have good education mainly when we compare with the, you know, mm-hmm. other regions of Turkey. We are more poor. We don't have all these economic, you know, things. And so usually we don't know foreign language. We don't know English. And so how I am asking you, them that how you can expect Kurdish people to treat you? We can't, you know.
Well, you need to come and tell.
We need to come and maybe help us, you know, to establish. And we don't have NGOs also anymore. Because in 2000...
Because they're where the Turkish government doesn't allow you to have them anymore.
They close. They close. After the emergency, after the coup attempt, you know, we have the emergency rule, you know. And in... yeah, you know, 15 July coup attempt in, mm-hmm. in 2016. Then they declared emergency situation in all over the Turkey. But we were always in emergency situation. It is another case. But after that, by emergency decrees, they closed most of the Kurdish NGOs. So, mm-hmm. for example, European Union opened lots of things about projects, etc., as funds for the projects. Okay. And NGOs can open them, but we don't have NGO anymore. Okay, mm-hmm. because they are all closed. They are all closed. Then you don't know it. Okay, so who will?
So it's like- also this idea of empowering and solidarity and coming together and raising your voice basically doesn't work anymore because you don't have the right and the infrastructure to do it.
Yeah, nearly all of them closed, Anna. Mm-hmm. You know, women NGOs closed, child NGOs closed, poverty NGOs, they are all closed. Also, especially when the Kayyum schemes, these state trustees, okay, they launch a war against Kurdish culture and language. Mm. It's another thing, okay? They destroyed all monuments, Kurdish, you know, that devoted to Kurdish important writers and poets. And they change our street signs. They change everything about Kurdish, you know. They close mm. Kurdish child centers. They close Kurdish film places. They close Kurdish theaters. Everything. For example, just 3 days ago, the trustee, state trustee in Batman, just they erased the, you know, the signs that write first pedestrian. They are all, you know, it was in Kurdish. They cleaned them. And, you know,
oh boy, as if there would be nothing else to do on this world, huh?
Yeah, everything.
So, but I understand that now better, I think, the role that we can play. And apparently, especially when it comes to the Kurdish region, it's also very important that we just go there and mm-hmm. shed light. But what is your own plan, what to do about the situation?
My own plan? I usually... sometimes my friends do plans, for example, like next year I will go here for holiday. I never have plans, to be mm-hmm. honest, never. I don't know tomorrow. So I usually live daily. And now I work for a long time voluntarily. What I know is first, after January, I need to find a job because till I can take care of children until January, but then I need to find a job because it is also hard for us, for people like me, to find a job in Diyarbakir.
Because you are, well, seen as problematic, I assume.
Problematic, they are criminalizing our names, but people like me, we come work for international media or international institutions, but they are based in Istanbul. Or people usually don't want to pay Kurdish people and many things, you know, like this. And for a long, I'm not only, I'm a human rights defender, you know, during even the coronavirus, I was in many places distributing food, you know, I'm an activist trying to do all these things. So, but when I say people, I say, no, I do volunteer, they say, how? Yeah, I say, you know, it is so hard after. But it is hard, you know, in every aspect it is hard. So what I don't have plans for it, to be honest. Never I do plans for 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, just because every day another thing is happening. So if something is happening, I'm just running there. For example, when in 2014, the ISIS, you know, came to, you know, Shanghai, you know, I immediately the other day, I was at holiday, but we stopped our holiday and I went to Iraq. And I worked with YSD camps, especially YSD women, for more than 1 year. And so every time we have these things, so I'm just, you know, passing from one place to another place. For long years, I work in the Kurdish villages who were burned during the 90s and village guard villages. We have different problems. And I work like 10 years for UNDP. And you know, so now I go like this. You know, sometimes I find some daily things. I do some daily things, you know. So it goes, I don't have class, just you know, these are every day we have another big thing. Big things never finish.
I don't know if you could see it, but in the comment section, some people were actually suggesting that you should also run for parliament. And then somebody was even suggesting that you should run for the European Parliament, which would mean that Turkey would be part of the European Union, which, well, I think wouldn't be the worst idea. At least it may help to improve, yeah, like press freedom and everything. So, Nurcan, I have my fingers crossed that you will find something that helps you earn a living and still being able to continue with the great work you do.
Thank you so much.
I'm very happy to know that there are women out there like you who know it's hard and who are struggling, which I think makes all of us human, but still continue the work. I really admire that, because the circumstances you are facing are so different from the ones I am facing, and even I sometimes think, oh, why on earth am I doing this? So I cannot even imagine how it may feel on your end. I have to say it made me very happy to listen to you and to hear that actually when we speak up here in Parliament or when we send these tweets, that it makes a difference. So I hope I can continue to do that, and I hope we will remain in touch and continue this female solidarity thing, which I hope at some point will change the world, at least a bit, because that world needs change. It really needs change. Yeah. And if you look around us, who are the bad guys? Well, I can't see many women there. Yeah. So, and I hope that also Turkey and the Kurdish region especially go through this corona pandemic well, and it doesn't get worse. And I want to thank you wholeheartedly for sharing your experience and your story. And I hope you find the strength to continue the work, Nurcan, because the world needs you and people like you.
Thank you so much. It's my pleasure.
It was really my pleasure. And I hope that I will have the chance to travel quite soon. And maybe also to Diyarbakir, if they don't stop me at the airport. We'll see.
Yeah, we will see. I hope. Take care. Thanks so much.
Take care. You too. Thank you so much. Bye.
My pleasure. Bye-bye.